So today we're going to look at the passage, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer, and review the vocabulary words by looking at the context clues that were available in order for us to guess at the meanings. So we're going to start at the beginning of the passage, and here we have a description of a beautiful spring day and Cardiff Hill, beyond the village and above it, was green with vegetation, and it lay just far enough away to seem a delectable land, dreamy, reposeful, and inviting. So I'm thinking that reposeful might have something to do with being dreamy and inviting. Maybe it would be a beautiful, relaxing place. Dreamy would be a synonym for that. Tom appeared on the sidewalk with a bucket of whitewash and a long-handled brush. He surveyed the fence, and all gladness left him, and a deep melancholy settled upon his spirit. So melancholy would be the opposite of gladness, because all the gladness left him, he became sad. He went from glad to sad. Melancholy is sad. And then here, in all of this, we have the reason he's sad, which is because everybody else is going to have a good time, but he is sitting alone painting a fence. So the rest of this is the conversation between Tom and Jim, in which Tom tries to get Jim to paint the fence while he goes to the water fountain. And then he says, "I'll give you a white alley." Jim begins to waver, because before this, he was saying, "No, I'm not doing that. I was told not to." But now he's thinking that white alley sounds pretty good. So Jim began to waver, means he's starting to reconsider, or he's starting to, you know, become less certain. So Jim stands around in indecision for a second more. When Tom sweetens the deal, he says, "I'll show you my sore toe." Well, this is too much for Jim. He takes the bait. He puts down his pail, took the white alley, and bent over the toe with absorbing interest. In another moment, he was flying down the street with his pail and a tingling rear. Tom was whitewashing with vigor, and Aunt Polly was retiring from the field with a slipper in her hand and triumph in her eyes. So Aunt Polly showed up to set the boys straight. She smacked Jim with the slipper and gave him a tingling rear, and Tom does what he's supposed to do, which he's painting with seemingly energy. He goes to work enthusiastically. But Tom's energy did not last. There we go. That's right. Energy is a synonym for vigor. He began to think of the fun he had planned for this day, and his sorrows multiplied. Soon the free boys would come tripping along on all sorts of delicious expeditions, and they would make a world of fun of him for having to work. Expeditions. That must mean explorations. And I'm to some extent using my personal experience for that, because I know that explorers would go on expeditions. I've heard that before. So it seems that these children are also going out on these great adventures. They're going all over because they are free. And so expeditions must mean adventures or explorations in the world. The very thought of it burnt him like fire. So now he's going to take out all of his wealth, and he's going to start to figure out how can he get somebody else to do the work that he doesn't want to do. He took up his brush and went tranquilly to work. Ben Rogers hove in sight presently, the very boy of all boys whose ridicule he had been dreading. Tranquilly to work. I'm looking, he must have gone, I could think it could mean sadly, or it could mean peacefully, quietly. Tranquilly, there's not a lot of context there, but I suppose, or unhappily. So there's not a lot of context here, but I would think, tranquilly must mean something about going to work, in a way in which he's resigned to it. Ben's gait was a hip-hop, skip, jump. Okay, so gait, that must mean the way he's walking. His gait is his walk because he's hopping and skipping and jumping like he's very happy. Proof enough that his heart was light and anticipation's high. Absolutely, he's very happy. He was eating an apple and giving a long, melodious whoop at intervals, followed by a deep-toned ding-dong-dong, ding-dong-dong, for he was personating a steamboat. Personating a steamboat. I would think that means that he's pretending to be a steamboat. I'm going to read on and see if that's right. As he drew near, he slackened his speed, took the middle of the street, leaned far over to the starboard, and rounded to ponderously and with laborious pomp and circumstance, for he was personating the big Missouri, and considered himself to be drawing 9 feet of water. Slackened his speed. He slowed down. He slowed down. And he ponderously and with laborious pomp and circumstances. Now, I know what the word ponder means, which is to think, but I don't think that that's what it means here. He rounded to ponderously and with laborious pomp and circumstance. He was a big ship. Ponderously must mean with great effort or clumsy, because he is trying to be this big, big ship rounding the water. He was a boat and captain and engine bells combined, so he had to imagine himself standing on his own hurricane deck, giving orders and executing them. Yes, so there's the context that tells me that he is having a difficult time. He's trying to be big, and he's really, truly, ponderously being exaggerating his moments. Stop, sir! Ting-a-ling, ting-a-ling! The headway ran almost out, and he drew up slowly toward the sidewalk. Okay, so I'll go on from here. Okay, so Ben goes on and on and on for the rest of this passage here, still playing steamboat, when he finally says to Tom, right here, "Ah, yeah, you're up a stump, ain't you?" No answer. Tom surveyed his last touch with the eye of an artist. Then he gave his brush another gentle sweep and surveyed the result as before. Ben ranged up alongside of him. Tom's mouth watered for the apple, but he stuck to his work. Ben said, "Hello, old chap. You got work, hey?" Tom wheeled suddenly and said, "Why, it's you, Ben. I weren't noticing." "Say, I'm going to swimming, I am. Don't you wish you could? But of course you'd rather work, wouldn't you?" "Course you would." Tom contemplated the boy a bit and said, "Well, what do you call work?" "Why, ain't that work?" Tom resumed his whitewashing and answered carelessly, "Well, maybe it is and maybe it ain't. All I know is it suits Tom Sawyer." "Oh, come on now. You don't mean to let on that you like it." The brush continued to move. "Like it? Well, I don't see why I oughtn't like it. Does a boy get a chance to whitewash a fence every day?" That put the thing in a new light. Ben stopped nibbling his apple. Tom swept his brush daintily back and forth, stepped back to note the effect, added a touch here and there, criticized the effect again. Ben watching every move and getting more and more interested, more and more absorbed. Presently he said, "Say, Tom, let me whitewash a little." Tom considered and was about to consent, but altered his mind. "No, no, I reckon it wouldn't hardly do, Ben. You see, Aunt Polly's awful particular about this fence." Okay, so consent means that he was about to give in, he was about to agree, but he altered, he changed his mind and said no. So consent is the opposite of no. Consent means to say yes, but he said no. Let's go on. "Aunt Polly's awful particular about this fence, right here on the street, you know. But if it was the back fence, I wouldn't mind, and she wouldn't. Yes, she's awful particular about this fence. It's got to be done very careful. I reckon there ain't one boy in 1,000, maybe 2,000, that can do it the way it's got to be done. So in the passage, Tom is being very clever, trying to convince Ben that what he's doing is something that only he can do. So Ben goes on trying to get Tom to let him paint the fence while Tom continues to resist when Ben finally says, "I'll give you the core of my apple." "Well, here." "No, Ben, now don't. I'm afeard." "I'll give you all of it." Tom gave up the brush with reluctance in his face but alacrity in his heart. So he looked like he didn't want to do it, but he most certainly did. He was very happy that finally somebody was going to do the job. So I'm thinking that alacrity means happiness. And while the late steamer Big Missouri worked and sweated in the sun, the retired artist sat on a barrel in the shade close by, dangled his legs, munched his apple, and planned the slaughter of more innocents. So sure enough, he's pretty happy. He's getting to do exactly what he wants. He's sitting around relaxing while his friends are doing all the work that he didn't want to do. There was no lack of material. Boys happened along every little while. They came to jeer, but remained to whitewash. Okay, they came to make fun, but they stayed to work. By the time Ben was fagged out, okay, I've never heard that before, that must be a piece of dialect. Tom had traded the next chance to Billy Fisher for a kite, so by the time Ben was tired, he had fresh recruits come along to take up the work. And then we have all of these boys paying all of this bric-a-brac, all of the payment for the work that Tom's allowing them to do. And one of the things is a dilapidated old window. Considering the list of items that he has, a key that wouldn't lock, a fragment of chalk, not the whole thing, a kitten with only one eye, some of these things really are not very complete. So I'm thinking that the old window that's dilapidated must be somewhat broken or in disrepair. So that would be what dilapidated must mean. Tom said to himself, we'll start here. Tom said to himself that it was not such a hollow world after all. He had discovered a great law of human action without knowing it, namely that in order to make a man or a boy covet a thing, it is all necessary to make the thing difficult to attain. You have to covet it, must mean to want it. You want it when you can't have it. So if he had been a great and wise philosopher, like the writer of this book, that's funny, that's a little bit of humor. Yeah, he said calling himself wise. He would now have comprehended, he would have understood that work consists of whatever a body is obliged to do, and play consists of whatever a body is not obliged to do. Well, I know what play is. Play is fun things, and work is not fun things. And so I think that obliged must mean you have to, like you're obligated. I've heard that word before. That's from my experience. So obliged and obligated seem the same. You have to do work. You do not have to do play. So going at the end here, the boy mused a while over the substantial change which had taken place in his worldly circumstances, and then wended forward to it. Okay, he was thinking, he was musing, he was thinking silently to himself about what was going on, and I guess I get that from the idea that this is what he's doing here. Nobody else is listening to him. He's just sort of thinking about the change in his circumstances and how smart he had been to get everybody else to do the work that he didn't want to do, and now he is off relaxing. So there it is. That is The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. And even though the dialect might have been a little difficult, the words, the vocabulary words that we came across really weren't that hard when we used the context clues.